the ecosystem. It's quite a vibrant environment there. You'll find a lot of people from all over the Middle East come to Bahrain now to start a business. One thing I want to mention though is, you know, unfortunately we have not been blessed with environments, let's say like Berlin, where everything was more or less in place from the legal point up to the executive point, with some minor adjustments. In the Middle East, you're starting from scratch, right? So just to give an example, just this year, a new bankruptcy law has been passed. That means now you're able to fail, right? In the regional context, even if you're an old company and you're about to fail, make sure you leave the country before you fail. Otherwise, you'll have to pay your debt before you leave the country again. So just to give you an idea of what's the difference to the mature economies in the region. So I don't want to, you know, talk
too much. So how many startups already, do you have a number? How many European or international, more international startups moved to Bahrain just for those reasons?
Well, in the end, it's a bit like a chicken and egg question, where are you from? In the end, they're all Bahraini companies. So at the moment, we're looking at about 50 companies. So as I said, you know, looking at the scale, we're quite on a small level. Most of them, I would say half of them are international, so they come from all over the region, and the rest are local startups.
Is there a specific topic or industry startups are focusing in Bahrain?
Yeah, I mean, two of the big ones is definitely fintech. We have about 400 financial institutions in the country. The other one is more and more being explored is e-commerce. E-commerce is really on a very low scale of development, but that also means a lot of room for development. So definitely we're looking more at the B2C side.
Thank you. Okay, so now we're flying back to Australia. Hello, I think we have to come a little bit here because we're not allowed to stand in front of this. Yeah, perfect. So Michael is representing the Australian startup scene. So please tell us a little bit about the kangaroos over there.
All right. Hi, I'm Michael. I run the Australian landing pad at BitHouse at the moment. The program is actually aimed to bring Australian startups here or to San Francisco, Tel Aviv, Singapore, and Shanghai. So I then want to pitch a little bit for Australia why it would make sense to actually go there. Of course we have kangaroos and the beaches, but just today I talked to some colleagues at the embassy and they said, you know, people should really be made aware that there is more to that. So Australia does have a vibrant startup scene by now. They have developed it over the last years. You do have co-working spaces and I think you will feel pretty similar to Berlin. It's a good place, similar lifestyle. I think Australia is a good place to start if you are aiming for the Asian region because it's in the same time zone and you do have a lot of people who do speak multiple languages and then also especially some of the Asian languages. So if you don't dare to go to Singapore or Shanghai and you rather go to a more Western country, come and visit Australia. I would say especially if you want to go to Australia, I wrote down some clusters. So agriculture, big thing, mining, health, and also transportation and smart cities. So if you're in that area, I think have a look. They have scientific clusters there, so there's a lot happening. 2 years ago, they had a National Innovation and Science Agenda with $1.1 billion Australian dollars to support for some startups. So if you're in that area, come to talk to me. And the Trade Commission actually supports you if you want to go over there, start working there. So
you just said if you're in that area, Australia, to my knowledge, is a pretty big country. So is it more Melbourne? Is it more Sydney? Is it more Perth? Is there like a startup hub scene over there?
I think it's almost like Berlin, where you have not one city center but multiple, and there it's pretty much the same. So I think Sydney and Melbourne are the main hubs where a lot is happening.
Okay, and you're also focusing on Australian coming to Europe or to Silicon Valley. So do you have a number, how many Australian startups are in Berlin, for example?
Okay, I think so far we have about 10 startups here. We are working on increasing that by the program, but sometimes application processing times are a little bit longer. But mainly, I mean, if we look at the program as a whole, then we have a landing pad in San Francisco and it's fully utilized. So I think Australian startups are eager to come abroad and expand their business.
Thank you very much. So now we have learned a lot about all the different startup programs in all these different countries. So let's all jump in one airplane and travel to all of those countries. But first of all, I want to open the discussion now, and I want to ask you if you have any questions. Doesn't look like it. No? Okay, maybe afterwards. So I think you guys are still around, so if you have any other questions later, just come and be in contact. Okay, thank you.
After hearing the startup pitch from all over the world, it's an honor to introduce you to the most famous startup pitcher in Berlin, Christoph from the Doctor Pitch. Christoph, the stage.
Yeah, hey, I'm Christoph. I'm also known as the Pitch Doctor, not Dr. Pitch. Come on, dude, branding. After we heard from all of these great countries how amazing they are, I think it wouldn't be fair to Berlin if it was now me talking about how amazing Berlin is. So what I want to do is I want to pitch you my startup, which is called Berlin, and we're in the startup home as a service business. Before I get into what our startup actually does, I want to give you a little bit of a company history. Because our startup was actually founded in 1237, so we're definitely later stage. We were going strong for quite a while there. Then unfortunately, we got a really, really terrible CEO in 1933, and we almost went bankrupt because of it in 1945. Thankfully, we got investors in that bailed us out. They got rid of the old CEO, gave us a new lease on life. Unfortunately, as it happens, those investors then started fighting amongst each other, so we actually had to do two products for a while, one for capitalists and one for communists. And that's obviously terrible because as a startup, you really need to focus. So we were very happy when in 1989, this ended, we got new investors yet again, and we started working towards the vision that we have for our product today. So what's the problem that we're solving with our product? Okay, let's imagine you're doing a startup. You have an amazing idea, okay? It's gonna change the world. Now you need to build a team, and you need to find a place to put your foosball table. And you need a place to put that, and you need to know which city are you going to move to with your startup. Now your first thought might be Silicon Valley, San Francisco. Yeah, right, like you're going to do that. Yeah, right, like you're going to do that. Seriously? No, you're not going to do that. You're not going to San Francisco right now. So what are the other options? We just heard about Australia. Australia is great, but we also heard one really important word, beaches. You're not gonna get shit done in Australia because beaches, that's where you're going. Australia is just too bloody sunny and too bloody pretty for you to get any work done. Do you like surfing? Do you like surfing? It's way too surfy. You're not gonna get shit done in Australia. And oh, by the way, you remember what happens every time you see a cat video online, right? Can you imagine walking to your office in Australia and seeing this? You're not gonna walk to the office, you're gonna stand there and look at the freaking koala for like 5 hours. And then, you say, okay, now I gotta go to the office. You walk like one more block and you see this guy. And you're like, that's so cute, I'm staying here. And then you say, but I really should get some work done. And then you go in there and then this guy shows up and then the day is over and you go have beers and you go to the beach or whatever. My point being, in Australia, you're not gonna get shit done. We heard about Chile. Chile is really cool. Unfortunately, it's too cool. When you're in Chile, you want to have adventures all the time. It's just an amazing place. You're not going to sit in the office and work. You're going to buy a car. You're going to drive to Patagonia, driving to the Atacama Desert. Whatever you're going to do, you're not going to get shit done. And also, the food. Do you know that in Chile, they put avocado and mayonnaise on hot dogs? It's amazing, but after one of those, and maybe even two, you're not gonna get worked up, so you're screwed again. Japan. I haven't been to Japan. Hopefully I'll go. But can you imagine being in a country where you can just turn on the TV and there's the most amazing sport ever on TV all the time? I don't think you're gonna get shit done. And when we're talking about too yummy, how do you feel after like 10 pounds of sushi? Are you gonna get work done? No, so you're screwed again. Bahrain? Really, we heard about it? $6.50 for a beer? Like that's a good thing? I'm not sure. I think the problem in Bahrain is they have good jobs there. So people don't have to work for your shitty little startup. They can work in a bank, they can work in tourism, they can make some serious money, so nobody's gonna work in your startup. So what's left? Europe is left. Or more specifically, the EU. The second biggest market in the world. I think that's where you really wanna be. When we talk about the EU, hello London, bye-bye London. Not gonna work, we're talking about the EU, so sayonara. How about Stockholm? Stockholm is a great place. But when you look at Swedish people, you're not gonna get shit done. You're gonna be distracted the entire time. Rome? No. You don't wanna be in a city where there's pressure to dress up and look amazing every single time you step out of your apartment. When I'm a founder, I don't even wanna shower in the morning. And don't get me started on Amsterdam. Because you might be able to withstand their distractions, but your coders sure won't. So nobody's gonna get shit done in Amsterdam either. But don't worry, because we have a solution to all of those problems. It's called Berlin. Berlin, where dressing up is not a problem. Berlin, where too pretty is not a problem. Where too sunny definitely is not a problem. Berlin, where too yummy is also not a problem. And Berlin, where too sexy definitely is not a problem. We have our beta out right now. We know we still have some work to do on the front end, but that's okay because our product vision is amazing and that's where we're gonna go. There's definitely no good jobs in Berlin. Actually, our former mayor coined the phrase poor but sexy for Berlin a couple years ago. It's been the motto of the city ever since. To make sure there are no distractions, we surrounded Berlin by this. We call it Brandenburg, and there is no way you're going there on the weekend. You're gonna spend your weekend coding, which is what you should do. If you need a little bit of a break, we have the best nightclubs in the world for that. Berlin has always been a very creative city. We come up with solutions to problems. If this guy was able to do his best work in Berlin, so will you. Berlin is also perfectly situated right in the middle of Europe, so it's very easy to get anywhere else if you want to do business in other cities. And this is only going to get better once we open our new airport in 2007. Well, that didn't work. 12, no, 15, no, 2018. We're going to open it. Maybe. I want to be honest with you. Berlin is not perfect. Our product has a couple of bugs left. For one, most of our product runs in the English language, which is really important for foreign people, but there's still some places where German is needed. And this being an actual German word, well, good luck. Also, we know that Germans, and especially Berliners, are grumpy. All of us. Well, almost all of us. But we tend to be grumpy, okay? So you have to be able to deal with that. And also we know we have way too many hipsters in Berlin. But we have our best people working on fixing those bugs. So they are gonna be a thing of the past very soon. Now I hear you thinking, but isn't Berlin part of a bigger product package called Germany? And yes, while that is technically true, Berlin is not really Germany. So when you use our product, you don't have to use any of the weird features that the product Germany has, like this, and like this, and like this. We don't do any of that in Berlin. Now, you probably want to know what is our business model. Our business model is very simple. We have in-city purchases. So from soft drinks to haircuts, whatever you're buying in Berlin, we take commission on everything. And also, when you sell your startup, when you're successful, we take 50% of that money and we call it taxes. And yes, in Germany you have to pay your taxes. I did a little slide showing you how Berlin is beating everybody else, okay? I think it's self-explanatory. Do we have traction? Yes, we have traction. We already have 3,000 tech startups in Berlin. And now you might ask, are they any good? And I'll tell you, they're fucking great. Here is a few of the best ones. You probably know all of them. Very, very big successes. The most important thing in every startup is the team. And we have an amazing team. And even more importantly, we have a great advisory board that's going to help us get to our vision. Now, the question for you is really just, do you want to be this guy or do you want to be that guy? It's your choice. Thank you.
Are there any questions left regarding where you want to do your startup?
In Best in Berlin.
I think so.
So the next one, startup competition, Nathan.
Hello everyone, welcome. Now for the grand finale, the big event, what you all have been waiting for, the startup competition. We are going to have 8 of the finest startups that are in an international mode come here, pitted against each other, fighting out for the grand prize of your acceptance and praise.
Yay. Woo!
The way this is going to work, how many, first of all, I want to get my startups to come down to the front row. If you are one of the startups that are going to be pitching, please come down to the front row. If you work for or are pitching for Uniware, Sheracy, Break Aphasia, Cortado, Three Your Mind, Vidamo, Future, FU2R, I don't know how to pronounce that. And Zenbu, please come down to the front row. While everyone is coming down, I want to thank and introduce our judging panel. We had some judges come from a long way to be here, and we are very grateful for our judging panel. I'll introduce the judging panel first. So, all the way from Brussels, we have Komarjev Chatterjee, and I hope I'm pronouncing your name properly. He is the founder of a drone startup called Unmanned Life. He is the chairman and founder of the European Young Innovators Forum, which is one of the largest young entrepreneurship forums in the European Union. And he is a leading expert on EU startup grants. So thank you very much, Komarjev Chatterjee, for being here. We have Sasha Schubert, who is the founder of a number of companies, including Spendino. He is the vice president of the Bundesverband Deutsche Startups, and he has come all the way from Wedding to be here. We are very grateful for you. We have Christoph Rettke. I blame my Canadian accent. Christoph Rettke, director of GTech and founder of the Berlin Startup Academy. And is there anything else I'm forgetting, Christoph?
That I'm writing for a magazine, that I have a talk show.
Oh yeah, a couple of things. Have a talk show. Check him out. He's amazing. And he came all the way from far away to be here.
Mitte.
We also, from a little bit further away, we have Nikola Mitic, who is all the way from Belgrade, the president of the Rotary Belgrade Metropolitan. He has come with 2 of his startups who won the Belgrade Connect. So we're very glad to have them here representing Serbia. And we have Masoud Kalami. Sorry, Masoud, if I'm pronouncing that wrong. The CEO of West Tech Ventures, come all the way from West Tech Ventures to be here. So it's quite an honor to have these amazing judges. And let me now explain how this is going to work. It's been a very fast-paced event. All of our startups are going to have 3 minutes to pitch. Our judges are going to take turns asking questions, and they have 2 minutes to ask the question. So, not every judge will ask every startup a question, but that's okay because the final voting on who will win is up to you, the audience. What you will do is you will go to the Startup Connect Berlin Facebook page, and there will be a question on the Facebook page of who do you vote for. Everyone gets 1 vote. Startup with the most votes wins. But the real prize is going to be the admiration and respect of you, the audience, and investors. Everyone clear?
Yeah.
Are we ready to go?
Yeah.
Do we have a timer?
Yes. And I'm measuring here the time that actually everybody gets 3 minutes, and afterwards you clap as have you heard the best pitch ever. I really count on your performance. Afterwards, we get the questions and we are ready to go.
All right, so can we get Uniware? And on deck after will be Sheresy.
Pitching after Christoph puts me in a terrible position, but.
So, just to mention, this is going to be live streaming, and we have some people watching as well, some investors as well, so Showtime, Globals TV, globals.tv, you can watch, follow the live stream.
Should we go? Okay, great. This is Gianluca from Uniware, and what we do is connecting university students. Now, every single university student, what is not going? Yeah, every single university student in the world experiences the same problem. They feel disconnected, they feel kind of abandoned, lost, because, I mean, let's face it, university is extremely complicated and complex. You have millions of issues you have to tackle, and there's no easy way to reach all your classmates to solve them. I mean, of course, there are thousands of different apps tries to connect people together, but there's not a single one dedicated to the vertical of university students. Now, what if we could connect, put students in touch through their academic data? Out there, there's a huge amount of data, academic data, that is unexploited. What we do is making use of that value through an automatic integration with university systems that allows us to know our users' academic data, like their grades, their financial profiles, their tests, the classes they're attending. Now, in case you're wondering, we don't need an explicit agreement with universities to do that, so we can scale as fast as we want. And yes, it's absolutely legal. You're Germans, so worth explaining. On top of this technology, we build a mobile application in which students can find the right people, the right content, and the right tools to manage their lives. Uniware is exclusive. You only find students in it, so no spam. It's structured. You find what you need when you need it. And finally, it's tailored to the student needs and interests that are very specific. This is Uniware, a mobile application that features class-based communication channels divided by topic, in which students can meet, discover everything they need. Now, this is happening now. We have more than 100,000 users in Italy, 52% of whom are active monthly. We have an established penetration rate of more than 50% in our top university, and a 7-day retention rate of more than 25%, so more than double of the market. This with zero marketing budget, so an extremely interesting traction. And we are seeing also on our business. Business relies also on data. We leverage our deep user profiling to provide students with opportunities. It ranges from job calls, internships, parties, whatever they're interested in. Now, this is us. We have an international experience in major corporations of more than 10 years. I do not have beards, but my co-founders have. And basically, we moved to Berlin because we want to bring Uniware to every single student in Europe and in the world, starting from Germany. Now, if you are interested in the project, please come and meet us. And if you have money to invest in, I would be glad to meet you. Thank you.
Questions, please. Do you have any proof of the monetizability of this? Because you mentioned that there's dozens of similar applications. There's a big one in Berlin called Jodel. And if you ask the founders for the business model, they openly admit to having none because they haven't found one and they're just going for scale. So how?
Basically, we are very different from Jodel because we are focused on the academic part. And we also profile very deeply users. We basically can prove this monetization with you showing you customers. We're starting to have paying customers thanks to our data. They need our data to target the right students with the right message, and we can do that. Did they answer the question?
What sort of proof do we have? Like, do we have money, numbers? You know, how much money are we making?
We are not making any kind of, you know, revenues in terms of closing the year with money. We are testing some campaigns. We have charging, for instance, 15 euros per lead for job offers. And there are a couple of guys that signed the contract. So, I mean, we are very young, so I don't have like a balance sheet to show you, but I can show you the contracts if you're interested.
Hi, this is Kumadir Chatterjee from the European Young Innovators Forum and other organizations. But again, coming back on the numbers, and I'm not trying to put you in a spot here in terms of balance sheet, etc.
Okay.
But you mentioned you have more than 100,000 active users, of which 52% are active once a month.
Exactly.
So first of all, how do you get that number, 100,000 plus? Is that just registered profiles? And what do you mean by active once a month? Because active once a month could be automatic login from my desktop.
Sure. Again, basically, what I mean, 100,000, I do not mean downloads, there are way more. I mean people that downloaded the app and actually logged in to the app. So that basically completed the funnel. This is what I mean by users. What I mean active, I mean that opened the app. I can explain it to you during this video.
Thank you. It's a very fast pace. It's always hardest to go first. Thank you very much. Can we get Sheresi up? Sheresi is the next.
Stay next to the table.
Hello everybody, I'm Martin and I'm thankful for the opportunity to speak here tonight. Now I present to you Sheresi. Our vision is to massively reduce B2B food waste by becoming the experts for surplus food. Imagine a secondary market for surplus food. That's us. Now, food waste is an ethical disaster and one of the major reasons for climate change. If food waste would be a country, it would be the third biggest emitter of greenhouse gases. Globally, one third of all produced food is wasted, and in Europe it's even 50%, and it happens all along the value chain. The reasons are high beauty standards, trucks come too late, don't fit their designated time window, or food expires and gets thrown away, although it's still perfectly edible. Now, we save huge amounts of B2B surplus food through our digital marketplace that connects supply and demand efficiently. We bring wonky or expired food back into the circular economy to consumers, to businesses at a small price. The benefits are better CSR profile, less disposal costs, certificates for CO2 emissions, and for sure a better usage of our natural resources. So it's a win-win-win solution. To start, as a pilot, we open a warehouse and the first food outlet store in Berlin. The key is that we bring to the market, deliver to businesses and consumers, perfectly good, safe food and with a same-day delivery service. To create a cutting-edge solution to tackle food waste, we teamed up with complementary skills. Rafael Fellmer is a social entrepreneur who started the food saving movement and lived 5 years in a money strike. Alexander Beauty is a passionate serial entrepreneur with a deep understanding of digital marketplaces. I'm a renewable energies engineer and have been involved in the food saving movement since the beginning. We solved the supply challenge with four major partners that give us their surplus food for free. We have our same-day delivery partners. We got a 100k loan to start burden operations, and we are ready to launch the PR firework with our media contacts to start the food saving revolution. We are grateful to see many doors opening for us, and the players in the field are confirming our model and the need for it. And we are determined to create an impact-driven startup to make the world a better place.
First question, how big can your impact be? And I remember I have read somewhere that like 80% of the food waste is already done in like initial transport, farming, getting stuff like outside of the cool houses, etc. And focusing on the last mile, like supermarkets and consumers, is actually the smaller part of the market. So how big can the impact be? And number two, in other markets you often see that the reusing or selling goods at a cheaper price, for example clothes, ruins the market for everyone else, because it creates a yet lower bottom level of, you know, goods prices, doing more bad than good.
Well, thank you for the question, or for the two questions. First of all, to the impact, as I showed, we save all along the value chain. So we save at the points where a lot of food waste happens, at the farmers where food is sorted out because, for example, the carrots have two legs or something like this, or at the logistics sector where trucks come too late or they do some bad planning, and we hear stories like 26 trucks of chips, potato chips, get thrown away because there's a logistics accident. So this is the target, and there where we can make a huge impact, and this we bring into to businesses and consumers.
So who's running the company actually?
We three, me, Alexander Puti and Rafael Fehmarn.
No, let the Alex out of the game. He has a lot to do, but you and your team, what is your skill and why you think you can make it? I mean, a lot of company failed to deliver exactly your promise.
I think our strength is a complementary team. Rafael and me have been involved in food sharing, which has today 3,000 corporations. We saved 7.5 million kilograms of food, and the movement has 25,000 volunteers. So we had.
Well done, well done. Okay, up next we have Break Aphasia, followed by Cortado. So Break Aphasia.
Stay as next to the table as possible.
Hello to everyone. My name is Uroš Mitic, and this is my family. We were a family like any other until my dad had a stroke which left him with aphasia. Aphasia is a language disorder that impairs person's ability to read, write, or even understand anything at all. Usually it happens to patients of stroke or Alzheimer's. Recovery takes time and practice, and how it is done now with the pen and paper involves a patient who is physically impaired to go to the therapist, or for the therapist to go to the patient, which many patients cannot afford. So, I'm a software developer, and I have decided to break aphasia with what I know. We are creating a platform. It's an exercise app for the patient and a data portal for the therapist. They're communicating in real time, and using the patient data exercises, therapist will be able to adjust, to track patient progress, and to create custom exercises and feedback to the app. So all the data will be accessible 24/7, which is awesome, right? But what's not? Many people suffer from aphasia, 2.7 million in Europe and 2 million in the United States. So we already started customer acquisition with the direct-to-therapist approach. Also, we have three early adopters who are helping us to form this subscription-based model. Actually, at this point, MedTech is booming. We are looking into a remote patient monitoring market, which is worth $10.6 billion. So this is us. We are a team of five. We won MIT Hacking Medicine in Belgrade, and with the help of a little of our advisors, who are telling us that with a little bit adjustment, we could tackle patients with Alzheimer's disease or children with different speech impediments. So this is great. This is what we need. We need 50,000 euros so we could integrate speech recognition and other advanced softwares. Also, we need to create a network of international therapists so we could get help from them and so we could help them also. That's it. Thank you, and let's break aphasia together.
Now, many of the people who are your patients will probably be older folk, you know, older people, right?
Yes.
And how do you, number one, how do you make a digital solution available and adoptable to them? What sort of traction do you already have? What's the key there?
Actually, we thought of that. Many, how it is done now, patients need a caregiver in any case. So caregiver will be the one who will download the app and use it alongside with the patient. So that's a must. And on the other side, my father, who has aphasia, uses our demo app, and he's satisfied with that. On the other hand, our advisor, who is a speech therapist, also is enthusiastic regarding therapist portal. So.
Okay, I mean, we didn't see too many features of your app, but mm-hmm. one thing that struck me on your team is that you're mostly software engineers and there's one UX designer. But where is the medical expertise?
Yes.
And where is the expertise to design a medical therapy experience? And what about regulation in Germany where you have to have that certified as a medical device?
Yes, actually this is a tool for the therapist. We have therapist in our team who is advising us regarding all the medical questions, and also a psychiatrist who is helping us regard that. Regarding Germany, we need to talk a little bit here with people, so that's it.
Do you have any competitor?
Yes, of course, but many of them are not data-driven. What they mean by that, they don't have a solution that directly communicates with patients. So, in real
time. Do you have competitor in Europe?
In Europe, yes.
Okay, it's, good, it's... thank you.
All right, Cortado.
Yes.
Okay, my name is Sven with Cortado, and we are managing the new workplace, the mobile workplace. And we're doing this for three reasons. First, the time we did our work in the office in front, sitting on a desk in front of a desktop PC was simply over. Mobile devices, smartphones and tablets are no longer considered by IT departments as a security threat, but as an enabler for improving business processes. And third, to be honest, working on a smartphone or a tablet is only fun with native applications on such a device. And while we say mobile first is the new norm for the modern workplace. And how are we doing this? Cortado delivers an app-based workspace on the device, an app-based desktop on the device, which provides the user file infrastructure within the organization and even enable them to print documents from the mobile device, plus adding productivity features like file sharing, for example. We really enable people to be productive, and that's our claim. It's simple, secure, and productive. And not only our satisfied customers are experiencing this, even the media and also the analysts are recognizing this. The media grants us nice awards. The analysts position us in the upright corner of the leader quadrants. And that's a pretty nice situation for us. Of course, there is competition in this market. We're not the only one doing this, but the competition relies on outdated technology or suddenly relying on platforms which disqualify their products for a lot of customers. And as a second point, Cortado is different from design, from competitive products, which enables us to get up and running in almost every IT organization within half a day, where others takes weeks to do so. So we are currently a team of 30 people here in Berlin, mostly being active selling a software in Germany, the DACH region, looking to expand to conquer Europe within this year, and that's why I'm here pitching to you and looking for partners to support us in this mission. So thank you very much.
So I didn't get it. Why are you here?
We need a strong financial partner to financial partner to scale geographically.
How old is the company?
It's a little bit difficult. The company is 2.5 years. The product has a little history before.
Yeah, because you won an award 2014 or something like that.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
Okay. And how many employees do you have?
We are a team of 30 people.
So it means you make money?
Yes, we do. We have 100 plus enterprise customers.
Okay, good. And where will be your company in 2 years from now, after you found that strong financial partner?
We are the leading enterprise mobility management tool in Europe. And after that, worldwide.
Wonderful.
How much money are you looking for? 3 million euros. Now you're in a market where there's tons of strong contenders and a very resilient market, from T-Systems to SAP to every integrator. They probably offer their clients similar things. So what is the one most important argument with which you break into this extremely conservative market? What is the one thing why people should use you, as opposed to all the people or companies out there that already have enterprise clients?
We get it up and running. That's basically it. It's user friendly, we get it up and running, and it's easy to maintain for the IT.
Isn't that what everybody says in that market? I mean, I have never met someone who said it's hard, we never get it integrated.
How much revenue do you have to date from these 100 customers?
500,000 euros.
All right, can we get 3 your mind up? And as a reminder, you can watch globals.tv, the live stream. And as another reminder, we'll be voting at the end. So remember, go to the Facebook page to vote after everybody has had a chance to pitch.
Those of you who think that 3D printing is just a fringe technology which is overhyped by some minor enthusiastic making community, think again. Industrial 3D printing is permanently disrupting the global production. No, it's no longer just a simple tool for rapid prototyping. It's now being used as an end-use part production, to which adoption is growing very fast. In this picture, for example, you can see a typical factory, which is more and more common for companies who already know that 3D printing totally makes sense. And very often, those companies are not really aware that they lack a software which can help them to manage their printers and help to develop an efficient workflow process. So that's actually good, because here we are here. Free Your Mind can offer a software which, first of all, helps to get the access to internal and external capacities, and also provides an instant printability analysis, pricing, and delivery time to guarantee a quality 3D print. So our market finds a use in more than 25%, and right now we can help to basically increase the usage of 3D printers in the companies. We can lower the overhead costs and also drive up the machine utilization. And in 8 years, our market will be between $3 and $122 billion. If industrial 3D printing looks like this, probably no one is gonna use it anytime. There's no money and no time to dwell in the process like this one. So what Freer Minds decided to do is to find a solution to streamline and optimize the entire 3D printing workflow process. And here, our vision is to build the number one distributed global factory. 8 of 20 biggest German companies are already using our software. And one of them is Volkswagen, who has 90 locations and run 3D printers there. And in order to help to save time and money and manage the printers around the world, they are using our software. And our company is established in 2014 with 3 different offices around the world. And also we are involved with some...
What's your main challenge?
Our main challenge is to become the number one platform in building a global...
That's not a challenge. That's a goal. You know, what keeps you from becoming the number one company?
So what we are looking for right now is the investment in Series A. And right now our challenge is to get this investment and scale up.
Why is that a challenge?
Sorry, I don't know.
Why? Because I mean, like, you're telling us that you already have 8 big clients, that like it's a world changer, that you know, it's a huge market. So why is it difficult to get money for that for you?
Maybe it's not hard to get money for it, but we are looking for the investment that's gonna help us, and
So what make you, let's say it in another way, what make you special? What do you have? Do you have a software? Do you have a team? Do you have, I don't know, market position or some secret? What is your secret?
So we have a unique software, let's say like this, which actually changes the way the machines in big companies are used. So. Yeah, we are just unique, let's say.
Okay, where is the majority of your dev team? And in general, what's the composition of your team? How many dev, marketing, finance, what's going on?
Our development team is based in our headquarters in Berlin. The marketing team is based in Berlin. We have a location in Wrocław where we run.
Good evening, my name is Michał Balikov, I'm from Vedemo. Vedemo is a unique cloud-based platform. It combines interactive video conferencing virtual classroom and unique management system which delivers, administrates and builds educational courses. It was designed from the very beginning with all stakeholders from the educational industry, with university teachers, school teachers, corporate trainers and kindergartens, our key partners, Sofia State University, Department of Pedagogy. Why is it needed? Actually, the learning, e-learning system, they have very low success rate. There's two types of online education. One is asynchronous, which means self-paced learning between materials. The other one is synchronous, which is live tutoring with a virtual classroom. And average completion rate for asynchronous only self-paced courses are just 41%. But when combined with a virtual classroom, it peaks to 91%. Vedomo is such kind of grand solution. E-learning solution market, it's booming. It's estimated to be 50 billion in 2021. The hot regions are South Pacific, Middle East, and Latin America with more than 20% growth rate. The market is very fragmented. There is no single player with more than 10% of the market. Our positioning is a cross point between the two domains. We have a very strong virtual classroom, and we have a lot of functionalities from asynchronous self-paced learning. We hit the top three priorities of the customers, rich set of functionalities, powerful virtual classroom, and price competitiveness. Our targets, it's universities, schools, and huge training organizations with e-learning platform, web-based, and single tutors and small organizations with a simple virtual classroom solution. Current tractions, 19 organizations using the system. From the beginning of the year, we have 14 paying customers. We start selling November 2016. Needed finance, 750,000 euros for future growth worldwide. Most of the money spent on sales and marketing. To wrap up, Vedomo is a brilliant LMS with powerful virtual platform in a huge booming fragmented market.
You are focused on universities also?
Universities, but the problem with the universities is that they have very slow sales cycle. So we, the main focus are small organizations, single tutors, vocational centers that will create a lot of small incomes. And the huge universities with their slow sales cycle. Our starting target regions are India, Pakistan, and Middle East.
Okay, not the European university.
Europe is very mature market. On the other hand, the whole market is moving toward cloud-based solutions like ours for cutting costs.
Okay. I invested in a company called Iversity, and they failed, and they raised actually 5 billion. So with T-System and some other investors. The problem was that university in Germany, they didn't work as they should, and then they started worldwide, and even Pakistan, and also all these countries, including Indonesia and so on. That one also didn't work, because nobody wanted to pay at the end of the day. So in Europe is free, and also in the world, nobody has the money to pay for that, you for that. So what is your main focus? Do you want to go to the small businesses, or but because the university...
Main focus are small businesses.
Thank you.
And this is a software as a service, not a platform?
Yes, it's software as a service.
Okay, it's white label for the user.
I didn't really get what it is. I mean, is it a video messenger that I can communicate with pupils with? Or, you know, what is it? What's the product? We haven't really seen it.
Okay, it's my mistake, sorry. It's a video conferencing environment with interactive tools for teaching of kids and people with low digital... No.
All right, coming up near to the end, future coming realities, future reality systems coming up next.
My name is Petar Pejic, I'm from Serbia, and I will present you future reality system product. In interior design, whole process starts with hand-drawn sketch, go through 3D modeling, and as a final product, clients always expect photorealistic render. This process is repeated actually a few times and until we get final design. So this whole process is really time consuming, require prior knowledge, and with tight deadlines it can be really stressful. Our solution for this is mobile application, which can scan hand-drawn sketch and automatically create 3D model. This 3D model can be previewed on this hand-drawn sketch as a small model in augmented reality. Inside this augmented reality space, you can insert furniture models and can change their position, orientation, change color, textures, etc. And everything is done on completely intuitive way. This is actually a stage of our prototype right now. In our future work, we're looking to develop architectural brain, actual artificial intelligence, which will guide the user through the design process and help him with suggestions. Final result will be a photorealistic virtual reality tour, which is actually automatically created, and it will allow user to make further customization inside this virtual reality space. Our business model includes two things: in-app advertising by promotion furniture producer and subscription for final visualization. Whole project is developed on the basis of my PhD research. In our team, we have a senior programmer with rich experience in artificial intelligence development. We have one of the best architects on Balkan, and we have our money guy. Right now, we're developing a minimum viable product, and we are in stage where we need 50,000 euro in order to develop this MVP in 5 months. After we finish that, we will start collecting data for development of this architectural brain, and we will start generating revenue. So, thank you for your attention.
For such an app, I would expect to see a video. Do you have a video you can show us?
I have a prototype, so I can present to you what we have and how it works in real time.
You want to win here?
Yeah.
Yes, I should vote for you. You don't have the video. Okay, no problem.
Unfortunately, we was limited with the tools for presentation.
Now, my feeling is that this has been tried and built about 100 times, and hasn't IKEA just come up with a similar tool, you know, that allows you to place the furniture into your room? Why now? How do you want to distribute this? How is this going to be profitable?
IKEA developed a few years ago, actually, their product is to show furniture in real space. So you can see it in real space. It has no connection with this architectural party process where you need to create walls, doors, so whole space, and don't have any connection with complete design process. So you are able only to put furniture inside that space. So basically we here want to target that whole process. Right now I finish architectural faculty and process is going, you sit with client, make drawings. Then you have a long 3D modeling process where you spend a lot of time of making everything in 3D. And at the end, client this day expect to see a render, to see photorealistic future look of their space. So when you get everything done, they actually they expect to change something small. And when you go again to the start, all process is long. So we think we are sure actually that with this our application we will speed up this process.
Just a question: who are your target customers? It can be real estate companies or studios or.
Timer. Can we get Zenbu up? Zenbu will be our final, last but not least presentation. I want to remind everybody to go to the Facebook page and vote on who you think is the winner after the last presentation. All right, take it away.
Thank you. Hello everybody, my name is Jacob. I'm from Sendu. I'm the lead architect and developer behind Sendu Social. So I'm a bit out of my comfort zone here. I like coding in dark rooms. But they sent me, and Sendu is a web application for social content, and what we want to do is to measure social content in a way that anyone can understand. Excuse me. And to do that, we take hundreds of insights and metrics and boil them down to the three marketing KPIs. Is it worth it? Are you reaching your target audience? And is your content effective? And so how do we do this? For the media performance, we look at the aggregated media values of your content and compare it to how much you spend creating the content, how much you spend advertising it, and publishing it. For your reach performance, we look at the reach compared to the target audience and the audience within your market. And for the creative performance, we look at the effectiveness of your content and the desired action compared to millions of other posts in our database. And here you can see a quick overview of some content in our app. As you can see, there's a lot of proprietary data from our clients listed as insights, and this is actually quite unique because we combine organic content with paid content and ads, so you can see them on the same level. A couple of our clients currently using the platform, and many more to come. And a bit about the future for Sendu, how it could look. Right now we are in the left corner, in the bottom, currently at $25,000 MMR. And within 2017 we could be in Berlin with the right investors, and we could be in the UK and New York doing $1 million MMR within 2020. And the reason we believe that is possible is because of this guy, Hardy, Christoph Hardy from Theo App. I'll let you read that and just say thank you for listening to me.
Now, as you probably know, there's tons of tools on the market that have a similar claim to fame. Everybody's using Google Analytics or specific tools on reputation management, on reach management, on click rates, etc. So what I was missing was, how do you stand out from that crowd? And there seems to be, every month there seem to be 10 new companies coming out promising the same.
I think basically we try to simplify all those metrics and insights and all those charts you can look at and into those three basic KPIs. And of course, we allow our clients to demand that we can make all those charts and print them out and show them to their bosses. But Sendu is also about learning how to create good content. So we want you to look at your content and compare it with content from other brands in the market. And from that, you can learn how to make better content. So that's kind of one of our main differences from our competitors.
How much money have you raised so far?
I'm not the economic guy, so I can't give you a number. I can hook you up to my boss.
That's not a good answer. You are here to answer the question.
Yeah. we have some VCs and some angels. I believe it's around 6 million Danish kroner.
It was the next question. Yep. Where are you come from?
You are from Denmark. Yeah.
Denmark, Copenhagen.
And you are based in Berlin now? Or?
No.
Okay. We're based in Copenhagen, and we're 10 people in our team right now.
Have you heard of a company called Social Bakers?
Yes.
And so they have more than 2,500 customers out there in all these geographies you're talking about. Secondly, if you're looking at the software-only model, why is it taking you so long to get to 1 million MRR? I mean, this is a road market. So what's lacking? What part of your software platform is not finished?
Well, the product is finished for now. That it's.
It's always hard sticking to the time limit, but I really am impressed at how all of you did. You all managed to come in under the wire with the time limit. I want to thank all of you for coming out to pitch. I want to thank all of the judges who took your time to ask these really insightful questions and bring out the next level of information from our courageous startup pitchers. And so now it's all of our turn. We're going to go to the Facebook page of Startup Connect, and there will be a poll. And the poll will have all of these startups that have pitched, and then you can ask, then you get the chance to say which one you vote for. And you also will have a chance right now to meet all of our startups and the judges during the networking event. Maggie Mario, you want to say exactly where on the Facebook page the poll is?
We have some internet connections challenges here, so it's coming up, so bear with us. So now I'll just give you a link and then you go directly there. So, should we publish now? I'm going to show the screen. So, you got it? The link? So here is select your startup, you just click there, and then you see the 8 startup we just pitched. Select your startup, or the 8 startup, then you submit, and then we're gonna get the result very fast. Okay, everybody selecting the startups, startup, the website, the Facebook page is Startup Connect or Lead. It's a public page for Startup Connect.
Yes.
There you are, you just select your startup, the poll, submit, and we can go to the results. How many minutes? 2 minutes more? Okay, tick-tack, vote. Maybe we can talk about the prizes, we can invite the people. Thomas as well, Lentos as well. So while you're voting, we'll have actually some perks from our partners and sponsors who put together for the prizes for the first, second, and third prize. So from Sevit, dear Andre, what do you have for the first, second, and third prize winners?
What do we have? Okay, so we have got about 3,000 exhibitors coming to Hannover next week for Sevit, and I hope we will also see you there. Otherwise, for the winners, we have tickets for the Sevit Global Conferences that will happen in Hannover during Sevit conference program with excellent speakers. You will also have the opportunity to ask questions to Mr. Snowden, the whistleblower from the US. So that will be via video because he's not coming to Germany. And we will be happy to see the winners there in Hannover. So,
thanks so much. We're going to check the winners soon. Joachim from Dentons, together with Thomas. You want to share what you contributed for the startups?
Sure, so we have actually legal packages, big surprise for the winners. So I think it's 5 hours of advice, well, corporate or general contract law, we can discuss with this financing, whatever you need for the first place, and 2 hours of legal advice for each of the second and third place.
Thanks so much, Joachim. All right. So we're getting close to the last minute until we close and then go for the networking for the buffet. The food and the drinks are waiting. I see some faces, hungry faces there already. So we go to the results. You done your votes?
Wait, you don't know how many people said saying that we can see the
So who got bought already? Who bought already? Raise your hand who bought already. Thanks for voting, thanks for supporting the startup, thanks for engaging. For the ones who did not, no food, no drinks. Okay.
Alright.
Okay, the last chance you get something to eat. Alright.
30 seconds,
okay. This is important. These are people who want to take over the world, they want to change something, and it's counting on you for your feedback as well. So cover this. So we have 50 participants, okay, for the poll. And we have already the winner. Okay.
Make it a little bit exciting.
Chan 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 chan. So
from the fan to the fans.
I'll just scroll down. So the third, okay, you can already see all of them. So welcome to the winners, the first, second prize. Greener, break after a 30 of mine and uni wear. Please come to the fourth. Pictures. This is the best reward, the applause from the audience, and to continue working on your startup to make this happen. So, I know you guys have traveled from the way from Belgrade to Berlin. That's the first prize. Let's start with the third prize first. Uniwear. Uniwear, Luca. Coming. I think we have a draw actually. Hold on a second. Something wrong, sorry. Hold on, wait a second. It's like the Oscars is going on. There's no la la la, sorry guys.
Stay, cut the camera.
There's no la la la, okay, hold on a second, there we go. Let's get the results now, okay? All right, 54, and we have Break Asia, Sharon C, and Free Your Mind. All right.
It's not sorted.
It is sorted, 9, 6, no, sorry, okay. I'll count them. Okay, check it. So, let's go. I need proper glasses, okay. So I start. The first one with 9 votes, we have Break Asia. It's Afia. All right, that's correct. Woo! The second one we have with 8 votes, Free Your Mind. And we have a draw actually on the third place on Sheresy and Future Systems. Woo! So let's bring all to the front. Let's bring the judge to the front as well. So how would you find the third place?
We shared,
okay, we take a picture. So come to the front, we're gonna pass the... You can hold together the third place, okay? Congratulations, picture for you. Big applause for the third place. This is the votes of the people. Alright. Congratulations. Pictures, video, live streams, snapshots. Alright, congrats. Good job. Alright. So second prize go to half and half. Okay. Free Your Mind, second place. Congratulations. And the winner, and we go for the networking, is from Break Asia, from Belgrade. Welcome, thanks so much. Let's ring the three winners.
Thank you. Andrei has to give the presents.
Of course, officially. Picture, videos. There you go. All right, well, before they hand over the prizes, we let you know how it's working. So the next is going to be some networking drinks at the business lounge. And then at 9:30, for the ones who want to continue, we're moving to a Maxim's, a club. They're welcoming us. We have free entries, free alcohol, free drink, and a special area for us, for all the Startup Connect audience. All right, let's go for a picture now with the judge as well, please. And the sponsors, all the speakers, all of us together. We've got a picture here. Marcelo, ready for the pictures?
Speakers, partners, sponsors, jury,
Christoph,
organizers,
judge.